Good morning to all of you. I welcome all of you to my lecture sessions on biochemistry for pharmacy students. So in this session, we will discuss in detail about lipid metabolism. This is the first part in the lipid metabolism. So here we will discuss in detail about digestion, absorption, and a little bit of outline on the metabolism of lipids. We all knew that in our food materials, we have three major ingredients will be there. One is the carbohydrates, then we will have lipids, and then proteins. So regarding carbohydrates, we had discussed in detail. So that is absorption, and then its metabolism, glycolysis, Krebs cycle, and how energy can be extracted from all over here. So this is what we had discussed in the previous classes. So lipids and carbohydrates majorly are considered as energy foods, whereas in case of proteins, it is meant for build of our body, okay, or else constructive work, okay, for we use proteins. Lipids are non-polar oil soluble compounds. Here we can segregate them into simple lipids and conjugated lipids. In simple lipids, we can have triglycerides, and from triglycerides we will derive fatty acids, and fatty acid derived compounds like prostaglandins are also considered as simple lipids only. Cholesterol is one major portion of non saponifiable portion in any lipid food material. Steroidal hormones that are derived from cholesterol are also non polar and considered as simple lipids only. Whereas in case of conjugated lipids, we will have a lipid bonded with other chemicals like sugars as well as proteins. So if a lipid is connected to sugar, we call it as glucolipid. Here example is lipopolysaccharide. So many examples are there. Whereas lipoproteins are a very important part in our lipid biochemistry. They help us in the transportation of lipids from place to place. Here these are the VLDL, LDL, and HDL. These are the three categories of protein. Lipoproteins are there in our general circulation. They help in the transportation of lipids from place to place. So let's see in brief about the chemistry of lipids. Usually, because in case of lipids, as and when we hear about lipids, the first thing that comes into our mind is vegetable oil. Okay, vegetable oils are, we call them as fixed oils. Okay, so they contain triglycerides. Okay, this is the glycerol portion. Okay, here OH will be there, OH, and OH will be there. So every one of the hydroxy group is esterified with three different fatty acids. These are fatty acid esters. Okay, so these are what we call them as triglyceride. Okay, so the triglycerides will be there. These are there in the fixed oils. So fatty acids, if you see, fatty acids can be highly saturated, unsaturated, or polyunsaturated. Okay, so here if you see this one, the complete chain is saturated alkane, whereas in case of oleic acid, here we have a double bond. In arachidonic acid, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 double bonds are there. We call this type of molecules as polyunsaturated fatty acids, or else we can also call them as PUFA, polyunsaturated fatty acids. Okay, so this type of chemicals will be there as far as triglycerides and fatty acids are concerned. So if you see vegetable oils, the chemical constituency of vegetable oils alters the physicochemical properties of oils also. The first example here is, this is palm oil, this is olive oil. Palm oil is slightly hazy as far as its texture is concerned, consistency is concerned, and it is relatively viscous, whereas olive oil is clear and more very low as far as viscosity is concerned. It is because in palm oil you will find palm oil contains palmitic acid. Palmitic acid is a saturated fatty acid like lauric acid. In lauric acid, how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So if you have all these, then we call it as a palmitic acid. Okay, C16. Whereas in case of olive oil, we'll have so many polyunsaturated fatty acids will be there. So because of unsaturations, the melting point or otherwise viscosity of the solution will go down. Okay, so this is the way how. And then the next one is from fatty acids, because in your biochemical system you can also have certain chemicals, like we call these chemicals as prostaglandins. Here the example I am giving you is prostaglandin E1. Okay, this is a signaling molecule, but still it is derived from fatty acids, and it is highly lipophilic in nature, so we can call it as a lipid molecule. And then the another major portion of very important biochemicals that are a part of lipids are steroidal molecules. Okay, cholesterol is this one, a very common ingredient in our lipophilic food materials, especially of animal origin. And then from here in our body, cholesterol is metabolized to give us different types of steroidal hormones, like one is progesterone, the other one is aldosterone. Okay, so this is actually mineralocorticoid hormone. These are hormones. Okay, they does so many important biological functions. So friends, this is the way how different types of chemicals are there in our lipid biochemistry. We'll be focusing more and more on fatty acids in the first part, and then cholesterol metabolism we will discuss in the latter part of our lectures. First, let's see how actually lipids are digested and absorbed. Okay, so as far as digestion is concerned, this is the process of treating a substance with heat, enzymes or a solvent to promote decomposition or extract essential components. Okay, what is it that we are eating? We are eating food material which contains several complex chemical molecules, and our body is not ready to absorb all those as such. So that's the reason why they have to be degraded into smaller parts, smaller compounds and simple compounds, so that they will be absorbed and assimilated into our system. So this is gastrointestinal tract. Starting from here, this is mouth, and then from mouth to stomach, from stomach to small intestine, and then to large intestine, and then the waste material will be excreted. So in between, at the duodenal junction, you will have connection with the liver, gallbladder, as well as pancreas will also be there here. Okay, so all these are like our digestive system. Okay, let's see one by one their role, as well as how actually they help us in the digestion and absorption of lipid molecules. First part is mouth. In the mouth, you will see that chewing is the main mechanical activity that degrades food material into smaller parts, and it also helps it mix food with saliva. What is saliva? Saliva is a concoction of different chemicals which help us in the digestion process. Especially, it contains enzymes. One enzyme we have seen in the carbohydrate metabolism, that is amylase. The second enzyme is lipase. So these are the two enzymes which will be there in your saliva. Both are hydrolases, means they perform hydrolysis reactions. And here what happens, let's see. As I told you, we'll be focusing more and more on triglycerides. Triglyceride is a huge molecule, okay, where it contains glycerol unit is connected to three fatty acids. Okay, the volume, molecular volume, as well as size, molecular weight, everything is huge. So that's why it cannot be directly taken up into the system. Hence, the hydrolyzable bonds that we have over here, all these three are ester bonds, they can be hydrolyzed by using an enzyme, we call it as lipase. Then we can release glucose as well as fatty acids in a sequential manner. So the lipase enzyme converts triglycerides to first diglycerides, and diglycerides to monoglycerides, and monoglyceride to completely it is degraded into fatty acid and glycerol. Okay, fatty acid and glycerol. So here, very important thing is, I am just simply telling you that lipid interacts with lipase, so that reaction will happen. But if you pour oil into water, okay, this is water, and if you pour oil, what will happen? They will form globules. Okay, they simply go to the surface and then coalition happens. Okay, they will merge and form a bigger droplet. Where is your enzyme? Your enzyme is water soluble and it is there in water. It means virtually your oil is here and your enzyme is here in different phases. But for a biochemical reaction to happen, for any organic chemical reaction to happen, oil and enzyme must be in a same phase. So that's the reason why we need to have a chemical for facilitating approach of enzyme towards lipid. Okay, so that's the reason why we have a separate mechanism in our body to facilitate digestion. So let's see. So in the stomach, as you all knew, stomach has special cells, are there specific arrangement. They are secretive cells. They are what we call them as parietal cells, which release HCl into stomach lumen. Okay, so here the main job of HCl is to maintain acidic pH, so that some of the enzymes that are there, you help us in the digestion of food material, especially proteins like proteases, etc. They will be activated, and also it maintains acidic pH, which is optimal for digestion of food, both amylase as well as lipase. And it also does the second part, that is, kills microbes, so that it will virtually sanitize your food. So once the enzymes are activated, once the food is mixed with acid, it will be released into small intestine through duodenum. At that portion, you will have entry of the synthesized chemicals from liver, gallbladder, as well as pancreas. Okay, liver synthesizes specific chemicals, we call them as bile juice. It contains bile salts, which will be released so that they will be stored in gallbladder actually. And then as and when food is released into the small intestine through this, the bile juice will be released into the lumen, so that mixture will happen, so that food mixing will happen. At the same time, okay, so from here, pancreas also release its synthesized enzymes. Okay, so in the last class, in the carbohydrate metabolism, we have seen this one. Okay, pancreas releases one pancreatic amylase, pancreatic lipase. So here, pancreatic lipase plays a major role in the digestion of lipids. So what is the job of bile salts? Let's see. So bile juice contains bile salts, which are actually steroidal metabolites only. Cholesterol, upon oxidative metabolism, it gives us cholic acids. Okay, up to this one it is cholic acid. So if it is conjugated with glycine or otherwise taurine, we call it as glycocholic acid or taurocholic acid. So here it is more like this entire part is non-polar, and here we have polar end. So it is almost like we have non-polar tail and polar head. Okay, so here it is like a soap. It is like a soap or emulsifying agent. It acts as emulsifying agent. So these act as emulsifying agent, so that the food that is coming out of stomach will mix with the bile salts, so that lipids will be solubilized in gastric contents. So then the enzymes that are released from pancreas will have access to lipids. So in this way, bile salts facilitate digestion of lipid molecules. In case of pancreatic enzymes, we have lipase enzyme, which does the actual required metabolic digestion part. So here, if you see, the cholic acid is this one. This will help in making micelles like this, where it solubilizes triglycerides, because inside we have triglyceride, and triglycerides are interacting with the non-polar part of the cholic acid, and polar part has access to the outside world. So here they facilitate, they help in the attachment of pancreatic lipase enzyme, so thereby it acts as an interface between triglycerides and the enzyme. So enzyme now has access to the triglyceride molecules over here, so they slowly capture triglycerides and hydrolyze them and release fatty acids into small intestinal lumen. So thereby from small intestinal lumen the fatty acids can be absorbed. Fatty acid transport across the cell membrane. Okay, so how actually it happens, I am giving you the big picture, and at the end I'll simplify this one. As I told you, in case of carbohydrates also, we usually have the idea that carbohydrates, otherwise glucose, is absorbed via diffusion. It is not diffusion, but it is facilitated diffusion. So we have transporter systems over there. So in the same way here also, because fatty acids are organic molecules, they cannot be absorbed by default. So they needed certain mechanisms. We have absolutely no clear idea on how it happens, but as far as the existing knowledge is concerned, so these are some of the proven pathways. So one of them is very popular pathway is diffusion. Okay, fatty acids can be absorbed via diffusion process, means the fatty acid is directly entering into the cytosol, because the phospholipid bilayer membrane is there. Okay, this is highly lipophilic, so that's why lipid molecules, if they are small in molecular weight, they can go through, they just simply dissolve and they will leave the cell membrane like this. And the second one is facilitated diffusion. Okay, so we have certain binding protein, fatty acid binding protein will be there, which helps in the transportation of fatty acids across the membrane. And the third one is, this is the transmembrane protein which works in collaboration with the fatty acid binding protein. This is CD36. These two help in pulling the fatty acid into the cytosol. The fourth one is facilitated diffusion via fatty acid transporter protein coupled with some kind of a synthetic mechanism, like fatty acids are drawn inside and the thermodynamic energy that is utilized in the coenzyme A synthesis is actually works in the pumping or otherwise bringing fatty acid into the membrane. Okay, so here we have fatty acid transporter protein is there, acetyl coenzyme A synthase enzyme is also there, so both these can work together. So in case of very long fatty acids, fatty acid transporter proteins exclusively they work in shifting in bringing in fatty acids into the cytosol. Okay, these are the five established protocols that we have, but diffusion and fatty acid transporter protein, so these are the two mechanisms which contribute to more than 90% of fatty acid absorption. So here we can also call these fatty acid transporter proteins as monocarboxylate transporter proteins. Okay, monocarboxylate, because carboxylic acids are there, they will be transported inside. This mechanism you will also see in the absorption of certain drug molecules like salicylic acid into our system, where monocarboxylate transporter system or transporter protein actually helps in the absorption of those molecules. Okay, the next one is a simple extension to or summary of whatever I have explained so far, and a little extension. So as I told you, the bile acids that are excreted from, that are released from liver or gallbladder, are mixed, and then here these are the micelles, micelle formation. Okay, so here what is the constitution of the micelle? We have this is the emulsified droplet where bile salt as well as lipids will be there. So in the middle you will find all the triglycerides. So you will have enzymes over here. So what the lipase enzyme does, it will do the digestion so that slowly the triglycerides are hydrolyzed so that monoglycerides as well as fatty acids are released into the small intestinal lumen. So these fatty acids are absorbed by processes which whatever I told you in the last slide, okay, via diffusion or otherwise facilitated transportation system. So they enter into the epithelial cells. So in the epithelial cell, what happens is these fatty acids are associated with certain smaller proteins so that chylomicrons are synthesized in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. These chylomicrons are released into lymph fluid, and from here they will be entering into blood. Okay, because in case of carbohydrate metabolism, we have a small intestine to blood. Okay, glucose is absorbed from small intestine directly into blood because it is polar. Because it is polar, so blood can immediately solubilize sugar so that it will not affect the consistency of blood. Whereas in case of lipids, so if the lipid is directly absorbed from small intestine to blood, what will happen? What happens? So blood will contain significant quantity of lipids, so thereby it forms droplets. Okay, if you form a droplet, it affects the hemodynamics and functioning of certain tissues like lungs. Okay, lungs and kidney, where these droplets may clog the vessels, and it also affects the viscosity and consistency of blood. So that's the reason why we have a separate mechanism where the fatty acids that are absorbed are converted to micelles or otherwise chylomicrons. These chylomicrons are released into first lymph, through lymph they will enter into blood. Okay, so if it is happening in this way, because in case of chylomicrons we have lipid core and outside we have protein environment, so this is more polar, hence solubility issues will not come over here. I hope you understood the concept over here. So here how actually it enters into blood and transfer, how it happens. So always these chylomicrons are absorbed by the tissues via endocytosis. Okay, the lipid molecule is over here, it is absorbed into the cell via endocytosis. So whenever these the chylomicrons have to cross various membranes, they will simply go via this type of endocytosis mechanism. So we are at the very critical juncture here. Now where we are, the lipids that we have in the food are converted into fatty acids. Now fatty acids have crossed the lymph region, and then it entered into blood. So from blood, the fatty acids or otherwise chylomicrons enter into liver. And then from the liver, first thing is these chylomicrons will be converted to VLDL. Okay, very low density lipoproteins. We will see what is the chemical constituency of all these lipoproteins in the next slide. Please closely observe here. This is a very simple logic. The VLDL has the main object to supply fatty acids and monoglycerides to tissue cells. Okay, so they are going through capillaries and then they will reach the tissue cells and they will release fatty acids as and when they are needed. And then because lipid content is getting reduced, so their density will increase. So they will become intermediary density lipoproteins, which will be taken up by liver cells again. Okay, through a receptor mediated process over here. So these IDLs will take in a little bit of cholesterol that is captured from the general circulation, and then LDLs are biosynthesized and released into the system. So here the objective is to shift the lipids into peripheral cells as well as adipose tissue. Largely LDL reflects the transport of lipids for mostly storage purpose. And then when it is entering into blood, it crosses capillary walls by the mechanism whatever I have shown you earlier, and then it enters into peripheral cells where the lipid content is released, cholesterol, etc., everything is released, and then the cholesterol that is diffused out of the cells because excess will be taken up by HDLs that are there in the circulation, and then they will take it to liver with a main aim to metabolize and excrete cholesterol. Okay, with an aim to metabolize excess of cholesterol and excrete in the form of bile salts. Okay, so friends, so this is the way how here up to this one. So this part, okay, this is endogenous pathway. Endogenous means LDL and HDL. The way how lipid is shifting from place to place via LDL and HDL is what we call as endogenous pathway. The distribution of lipid via chylomicrons, VLDL and IDL is what we call it as exogenous pathway. So the levels of VLDL and IDL are largely dependent on chylomicron levels, and it has direct connection to food. Okay, that's the reason why we call this circulation, rather this pathway is exogenous pathway, whereas LDL and HDL are largely dependent on your internal biochemistry. So that's why endogenous pathway, we call it as endogenous pathway. Okay friends, so this is the way how different type of lipoproteins help in distribution of food material or lipid materials in our body. So here I just would like to mention you a few things, like if your food is highly lipophilic, okay, let's say you had biryani, and immediately it reflects in VLDL level. Okay, this is like acute reflector of your food. Whereas let's say you are having a lot of food, so what will happen, because usually when you have food you will get energy, or it food will be stored as energy. Let's say when energy requirements are not there, what will happen, large quantity of food whatever we have consumed will move towards storage sites. Okay, so as far as storage sites are concerned, we have glycogen as one of the storage. The second one is triglycerides in adipose tissue. Okay, adipose tissue. So if you take our body is symmetric, largely symmetric. Okay, and then when you are taking a lot of food material and no energy or no exercise is there, that fat will deposit in all your tissues. Okay, in a uniform manner, in a relatively uniform manner, like this. So how come the distribution is happening in a uniform manner, or otherwise symmetric manner relatively? Okay, so when a fatty acid or the lipid material is there, LDL is reaching a tissue in this way. Let's say here the adipose tissue is full, then it gives a signal in such a manner that the material is directed to the opposite side. Okay, so if it is also full, then it will go to another site. So this type of transition usually happens with LDL. So that's the reason why LDL levels reflects more like the lipid adipose tissue, or otherwise excess of energy that we have in our body. And if you have more and more quantity of LDL, obviously here excess of cholesterol that is going to be diffused out. So this kind of a situation enhances, because when we have so much of free flowing lipid in the blood vessel, if the blood vessels are large, like bigger vessels are there, no problem. but they will go into smaller capillaries. Here there is a possibility of clogging. There is a possibility of clogging, which may lead to blood clots. So this will lead to myocardial ischemia and finally cardiac failure. Okay, so this is the reason why LDL is considered as bad cholesterol. But here you can see HDL is actually clearing cholesterol from our system. So more HDL indicates that our body is actually consuming so much of lipid, means our body is physically very active. So that's the reason why HDL is considered as good cholesterol. Okay, it has nothing to do with cholesterol, but good and bad reflects your body condition. Okay, so friends, I hope you understood the logic here. The lipids that entered into our body are distributed by associating with different kinds of proteins. So that's why this combination is what we call them as lipoproteins. So all these lipoproteins, they does specific jobs. In some of the cases like VLDL over here, this VLDL does the preliminary supply of lipids to the different kinds of tissues that we have. And LDL, what it does, it shifts, otherwise it helps in the transport of lipids from various peripheral tissues, and largely its job is to go for to transport lipids for storage purpose. And then HDL, what it does, it transports cholesterol and lipid materials for metabolism purpose, okay, not for construction but destruction. So this is the way how various lipoproteins help run our system. We need to have a little bit of discussion regarding lipoproteins. Okay, so in case of lipoprotein, so this is like a small portion of lipoprotein. Lipoprotein's consistency is chemical constitution is like this. So the outer core contains fatty acids, cholesterol, and protein. Okay, joined together. So in this way, and then the inner core largely contains cholesterol esters. Okay, cholesterol contain a hydroxy group that is esterified with fatty acid, so that the entire core contains large quantity of the cholesterol esters. So if you go from chylomicron to HDL, the size of the particle goes down. Okay, the chylomicron is the biggest particle containing large proportion of lipids and cholesterol, triglycerides, etc., and very less concentration of proteins like this. So what is the job of the proteins? Here is the logic. Okay, let's say in the general circulation we have a cholesterol molecule. Okay, we have a cholesterol molecule. Now it has to be transported to metabolism, to liver. Okay, and cholesterol that is meant for metabolism or for some other purpose has absolutely no difference as far as chemistry is concerned. So that's the reason why we need to give an address tag. An address tag. How it is possible? Address tag is needed. Otherwise, cholesterol may go from one cell to another cell or any other tissue. So that's the reason why our design is like we add proteins which act as signature molecules, so that because proteins have specific three-dimensional shape and size. Okay, so that's why it can act as a signature. So in that way they help in recognizing various tissues, and they can also function as receptor sites. So that's the reason why lipoproteins are needed for transportation of lipids from place to place. As you move from chylomicron to HDL, the size gradually reduces. Further, the proportion of weight by weight, if you see the proportion of protein increases. Okay, relatively it is very high. And if you go from here to here, the triglyceride content is very very less. In case of HDL, it largely carries cholesterol. Okay, so this is the way how you can see difference in the chemical constitution as well as size of lipoprotein granules. So here in this table you can see further details, like as I told you, chylomicron is of very less density because of its high concentration of fatty acids, high proportion of fatty acids in this. And then if you compare the protein content, HDL content, 40 to 45% of its dry weight is actually protein only, whereas in chylomicron very less. And here you can see the protein content is also entirely different, because here apoproteins, the proteins which actually participate in formation of lipoproteins, or what we call them as apoproteins, here you can see different combinations. Scientists found different types of proteins are involved in the in the synthesis of these lipoproteins. In chylomicrons, A1, A2, A4, etc., these are all there. But in case of LDL, you can find B100 and E dominate as far as the protein content is concerned. Okay, so this is the way how different kinds of lipoproteins help us in the transportation of lipids from the site of biosynthesis to site of utilization, or site of storage to site of metabolism. Okay. So friends, we are at the end of the lecture. So I would like to summarize the lecture. Lipids are oil soluble. Okay, major portion of these lipids go into energy production, and also because fatty acids and cholesterol are meant for cell membrane biosynthesis. Okay, here lipids are absorbed from small intestine in the first 1/4 of small intestine via both diffusion process and transportation process. Okay, so they will go into lymph, from lymph to blood. Okay, so from blood they will go to liver. In liver they will be converted into, because here they are chylomicrons, so in the liver they will be converted into VLDL. So they supply fatty acids to tissues and they will be converted to IDL. So this IDL will pick up, will go to liver and pick up cholesterol, and it will be converted to LDL. LDL will go to peripheral tissues and gives away cholesterol. So this cholesterol is picked up by HDL and it will submit it to liver for metabolism. Okay, so this is the way how the transportation of lipid happens. Because LDL reflects excess of lipids in our body, because more number of free flowing lipids means what? All your adipose tissues are full. Okay, when their storage site is full, then only you will find more quantity of LDL in your bloods. Okay, that's the reason why LDL is considered as bad cholesterol, because there is so much of statistical significance between LDL level and atherosclerosis or cardiac problems. So that's the reason why LDL is called as bad cholesterol, whereas HDL indicates active state of your body, or otherwise you are doing so much of physical exercise. So that's why HDL is called as good cholesterol. So estimation of HDL level, LDL level, VLDL level and triglyceride is what we call it as lipid profile test. Okay, so friends, I hope you understood the concept of lipid biochemistry, especially digestion, absorption and distribution throughout your body. Please let me know if you have any doubts, or otherwise if any concept is not clear, please let me know through the comment section, so that I will respond. Okay, please share this video with your friend so that they will also get benefited out of this. I am thankful to you for your time and patient listening. I'll meet you again with another important lecture on lipid metabolism. Okay. So here, fatty acid metabolism or beta oxidation. We'll discuss in detail in the next class. Okay. Thank you all. See you again. Bye.